Rabbit Run by John Updike, continued. Rabbit laughs, and Lucy, having delivered the Cheerios, too much milk, he is used to living with Ruth, who let him pour his own milk, he likes just enough to take away the dryness, so that the milk and cereal come out even, chats on gaily. The worst thing that happened, in connection with some committee or other, Jack was talking with one of the vestrymen over the phone, and had the idea that it would buck this poor soul up to be given a church job, so he said, why not make Happy Beans the chairman of something or other? Well, the man on the other end of the line said, Happy who? And Jack realized what he'd said, but instead of just sloughing it off like anybody else would have, Jack tells the whole story about the children calling him Happy Beans. And, of course, this stuffy old vestryman doesn't think it's at all funny. He was a friend, you see, of Happy Beans. They weren't exactly business associates, but often had lunch together over in Brewer. That's the thing about Jack. He always tells people too much. Now, this vestryman is probably telling everybody how the rector pokes fun of this poor, miserable Happy Beans. He laughs again. His coffee comes in a thin, shallow cup monogrammed in gold, and Lucy sits down opposite him at the table with a cup of her own. He said, I'm going to stop being naughty, Rabbit says. Yes, he's overjoyed. He went out of here virtually singing. It's the first constructive thing he thinks he's done since he came to Mount Judge. Rabbit yawns. Well, I don't know what he did. I don't either, she says. But to hear him talk, the whole thing was on his shoulders. This suggestion that he's been managed rubs him the wrong way. He feels his smile creak. Really? Did he talk about it? Oh, all the time. He's very fond of you. I don't know why. I'm just lovable. That's what I keep hearing. You have poor old Mrs. Smith wrapped around your little finger. She thinks you're marvelous. And you don't see it? Maybe I'm not old enough. Maybe if I were 73. She lifts the cup to her face and tilts it, and the freckles on her narrow white nose sharpen in proximity to the steaming brown coffee. She is a naughty girl. Yes, it's very clear, a naughty girl. She sets the cup down and looks at him with round green eyes, and the triangular white space between her eyebrows seems to look and mock, too. Well, tell me, how does it feel to be a new man? Jack's always hoping I'll reform, and I want to know what to expect. Are you born anew? Oh, I feel about the same. You don't act the same. He grunts, well, and shifts in his chair. Why does he feel so awkward? She is trying to make him feel foolish and sissy just because he's going to go back to his wife. It's quite true, he doesn't act the same. He doesn't feel the same with her either. He's lost the nimbleness that led him so lightly into tapping her backside that day. He tells her, last night driving home I got this feeling of a straight road ahead of me. Before that it was like I was in the bushes and it didn't matter which way I went. Her small face above the coffee cup held in two hands like a soup bowl is perfectly tense with delight. He expects her to laugh and instead she smiles silently. He thinks, she wants me. Then he thinks of Janice with her legs paralyzed talking about toes and love and orangeade. And this perhaps seals shut something in his face, for Lucy Eccles turns her head impatiently and says, Well, you better get going down that nice straight road. It's 20 of 1. How long does it take to walk to the bus stop? Not long. I'd drive you to the hospital if it weren't for the children. She harks. Speak of the devil, here comes one. As he's pulling on his socks, the older girl sneaks into the kitchen, dressed just in underpants. Joyce! Her mother halts halfway to the sink with the empty cups. You get right back up to bed. Hello, Joyce, Rabbit says. Did you come down to see the naughty man? Joyce stares and hugs the wall with her shoulder blades. Her long golden stomach protrudes thoughtfully. Joyce, Lucy says, didn't you hear me? Why doesn't he have his shirt on? The child asks distinctly. I don't know, her mother says. I suppose he thinks he has a nice chest. I have a T-shirt on, he protests. It's as if neither of them see it. Is that his bosom? Joyce asks. No, darling, only ladies have bosoms. We've been through that. Hell, if it makes everybody nervous, Rabbit says, and puts on his shirt. It's rumpled and at the collar and cuffs gray. He put it on clean to go to the club castanet. He has no coat. He left Ruth too hastily. Okay, he says, tucking in the tail. Thank you very much. You're very welcome, Lucy says. Be good now. The two girls walk with him down the hall. Lucy's white legs mix in pallor with the child's naked chest. Little Joyce keeps staring up at him. He wonders what she's puzzling about. Children and dogs smell things. He tries to calculate how much sarcasm was in that "be good now," and what it meant, if anything. He wishes she could drive him. He really wants to get into a car with her. Not so much to do anything as just feel how things set. His reluctance to leave pulls the air between them taut. They stand at the door, he and Eccles' baby-skinned wife, and under them Joyce's face looking up with her father's wide lips and arched eyebrows, and under them all, Lucy's painted toenails, tiny scarlet shells in a row on the carpet. He strums the air with a vague disclaimer and puts his hand on the hard doorknob. The thought that only ladies have bosoms haunts him foolishly. He looks up from the toenails to Joyce's watching face, and from there to her mother's bosom. Two pointed bumps under a buttoned blouse that shows through its airy summer weave the white shadow of the bra. When his eyes reach Lucy's, an amazing thing enters the silence. The woman winks, quick as light. Maybe he imagined it. He turns the knob and retreats down the sunny walk with a murmur in his chest, as if a string in there had snapped. At the hospital, they say Janice has the baby with her for a moment, and would he please wait? He is sitting in the chair with chrome arms leafing through a woman's day backwards, when a tall woman with beautiful gray hair and somehow silver, finely wrinkled skin comes in and looks so familiar he stares. She sees this and has to speak. He feels she would have preferred to ignore him. Who is she? Her familiarity has touched him across a great distance. She looks into his face reluctantly and tells him, "You're an old student of Marty's. I'm Harriet Totherow. We had you to dinner once. I can almost think of your name." Yes, of course. But it wasn't from that dinner he remembers her. It was from noticing her on the streets. The students at Mount Judge High knew, most of them, that Totherow played around, and his wife appeared to their innocent eyes wreathed in dark flame, a walking martyr, a breathing shadow of sin. It was less pity than morbid fascination that singled her out. Totherow was himself such a clown and windbag, such a speechifier, that the stain of his own actions slid from him, oil off a duck. It was the tall, silver, serious figure of his wife that accumulated the charge of his wrongdoing and released it to their young minds with an electrical shock that snapped their eyes away from the sight of her, in fear as much as embarrassment. Harry stands up, surprised to feel that the world she walks in is his world now. "I'm Harry Angstrom," he says. "Yes, that's your name. He was so proud of you. He often talked to me about you, even recently." Recently? What did he tell her? Does she know about him? Does she blame him? Her long, school-marmish face, as always, keeps its secrets in. "I've heard that he was sick." "Yes, he is, Harry. Quite sick. He's had two strokes, one since he came into the hospital." "He's here?" "Yes, would you like to visit him? I know it would make him very happy. For just a moment. He's had very few visitors. I suppose that's the tragedy of teaching school. You remember so many, and so few remember you." "I'd like to see him, sure." "Come with me, then." As they walk down the halls, she says, "I'm afraid you'll find him much changed." He doesn't take this in fully. He is concentrating on her skin, trying to see if it does look like a lot of little lizard skins sewed together. Just her hands and neck show. Totherow is in a room alone. White curtains seem to hang expectantly around his bed. Green plants on the windowsills dutifully exhale oxygen. Canted panes of glass lift the smells of summer into the room. Footsteps crunch on the gravel below. "Dear, I've brought you someone. He was waiting outside in the most miraculous way." "Hello, Mr. Totherow. My wife's had her baby." He speaks these words and goes toward the bed with blank momentum. The sight of the old man lying there shrunken, his tongue sliding in his lopsided mouth, has stunned him. Totherow's face, spotted with white stubble, is yellow in the pillows, and his thin wrists stick out from candy-striped pajama sleeves beside the shallow lump of his body. Rabbit offers his hand. "He can't lift his arms, Harry," Mrs. Totherow says. "He is helpless. But talk to him. He can see and hear." Her sweet, patient enunciation has a singing quality that is sinister, like a voice humming in empty rooms. Since he has extended his hand, Harry presses it down on the back of one of Totharo's. For all its dryness, the hand under a faint, scratchy fleece is warm, and to Harry's horror, moves, revolves stubbornly, so the palm is presented upward to Harry's touch. Harry takes his fingers back and sinks into the bedside chair. His old coach's eyeballs shift with scattered quickness as he turns his head an inch toward the visitor. The flesh under them has been so scooped that they are weakly protrusive. Talk. He must talk. It's a little girl. I want to thank you, he speaks loudly, for the help you gave in getting me and Janice back together again. You were very kind. Totharo retracts his tongue and shifts his face to look at his wife. A muscle under his jaw jumps, his lips pucker, and his chin crinkles repeatedly like a pulse as he tries to say something. A few dragged vowels come out. Harry turns to see if Mrs. Totharo can decipher them, but to his surprise, she is looking elsewhere. She is looking out the window, toward an empty green courtyard. Her face is like a photograph. Is it that she doesn't care? If so, should he tell Totharo about Margaret? But there was nothing to say about Margaret that might make Totharo happy. I'm straightened out now, Mr. Totharo, and I hope you're up and out of this bed soon. Totharo's head turns back with an annoyed quickness, the mouth closed, the eyes in a half-squint, and for this moment he looks so coherent Harry thinks he will speak, that the pause is just his old disciplinarian's trick of holding silent until your attention is complete. But the pause stretches, inflates, as if, used for 60 years to space out words, it at last has taken on a cancerous life of its own and swallowed the words. Yet in the first moments of the silence, a certain force flows forth. A human soul emits its invisible and scentless rays with urgency. Then the point in the eyes fades, the brown lids lift and expose pink jelly, the lips part, the tip of the tongue appears. I better go down and visit my wife, Harry shouts. She just had the baby last night. It's a girl. He feels claustrophobic, as if he's inside Totharo's skull. When he stands up, he has the fear he will bump his head, though the white ceiling is yards away. Thank you very much, Harry. I know he's enjoyed seeing you, Mrs. Totharo says. Nevertheless, from her tone, he feels he's flunked a recitation. He walks down the hall springingly, dismissed. His health, his reformed life, make space, even the antiseptic space in the hospital corridors, delicious. Yet his visit with Janice is disappointing. Perhaps he is still choked by seeing poor Totharo stretched out as good as dead. Perhaps out of ether Janice is choked by thinking of how he's treated her. She complains a lot about how much her stitches hurt, and when he tries to express his repentance again, she seems to find it boring. The difficulty of pleasing someone begins to hem him in. She asks why he hasn't brought flowers. He had no time. He tells her how he spent the night, and sure enough, she asks him to describe Mrs. Eccles. About your height, he says. Freckles. Her husband's been wonderful, she says. He seems to love everybody. He's okay, Rabbit says. He makes me nervous. Oh, everybody makes you nervous. No, now that's not true. Marty Totharo never made me nervous. I just saw the poor old bastard, stretched out in a bed up the hall. He can't say a word or move his head more than an inch. He doesn't make you nervous, but I do, is that right? I didn't say that. Oh, no. Ow! These damn stitches, they feel like barbed wire. I just make you so nervous you desert me for 2 months. Over 2 months. Well, Jesus, Janice. All you did was watch television and drink all the time. I mean, I'm not saying I wasn't wrong, but it felt like I had to. You get the feeling you're in your coffin before they've taken your blood out. On that first night when I got in the car in front of your parents' place, even then I might just as easy have gone down to get Nelson and driven it home. But when I let the brake out, her face goes into that bored look again. Her head switches from side to side as if to keep flies from settling. He says, shit. This gets her. She says, I see your language hasn't been improved by living with that prostitute. She wasn't a prostitute exactly. She just kind of slept around. I think there are a lot of girls like her around. I mean, if you're going to call everybody who isn't married a prostitute, where are you going to stay now, until I get out of the hospital? I thought Nelson and me would move into our apartment. I'm not sure you can. We didn't pay any rent on it for 2 months. Huh? You didn't? Well, my goodness, Harry, you expect a lot. You expect Daddy to keep paying rent? I didn't have any money. Well, did the landlord call? What happened to our furniture? Did he put it out on the street? I don't know. You don't know? Well, what do you know? What have you been doing all this time? Sleeping? I was carrying your baby. Well, hell, I didn't know you had to keep your whole mind on that all the time. The trouble with you, kid, is you just don't give a damn, really. Well, listen to you. He does listen to what he's been sounding like, remembers how he felt last night, and after a pause, tries to begin all over again. Hey, he says, I love you. I love you, she says. Do you have a quarter? I guess. I'll look. What do you want it for? If you put a quarter in that, she points toward a small television set on a high stand so patients can see it over the foot of their beds, it'll play for an hour. There's a silly program on it, too, that Mother and I got to watching when I was home. So for 30 minutes, he sits by her bed, watching some curly-haired MC tease a lot of elderly women from Akron, Ohio and Oakland, California. The idea is all these women have tragedies they tell about and then get money according to how much applause there is. But by the time the MC gets done, delivering commercials and kidding them about their grandchildren and their girlish hairdos, there isn't much room for tragedy left. Rabbit keeps thinking that the MC, who has that way of a Jew of pronouncing very distinctly, no matter how fast the words, is going to start plugging the Magipeel peeler. But the product doesn't seem to have hit the big time yet. It's not too bad. A pair of peroxide twins with twitchy tails push the women around to various microphones and booths and applause areas. It even makes for a kind of peace. He and Janice hold hands. The bed is almost as high as his shoulders when he sits down, and he enjoys being in this strange relation to a woman, as if he's carrying her on his shoulder, but without the weight. He cranks her bed up and pours her a drink of water, and these small services suit some need he has. The program isn't over when a nurse comes and says, Mr. Angstrom, if you want to see your baby, the nurse is holding them to the window now. He goes down the hall after her. Her square hips swing under the starched white. From just the thickness of her neck, he figures her for a good solid piece. Haunchy. Big above the knee. He does like women big above the knee. Also, he's worrying about what a woman from Springfield, Illinois, was going to say happened after her son's dreadful automobile accident in which he lost an arm. So he's quite unprepared when the nurse in the baby room, where little bundles with heads like oranges lie in rows of supermarket baskets, some tilted, brings his girl to the viewing window. And it's like a damper being slid back in his chest. A sudden stiff draft freezes his breath. People are always saying how ugly new babies are. Maybe this is the reason for the amazement. The baby is held by the nurse, so her profile is sharp red against the buttoned white bosom of the uniform. The folds around the nostril, worked out on such a small scale, seem incredibly precise. The tiny stitchless seam of the closed eyelid runs diagonally a great length, as if the eye, when it is opened, will be huge and see everything and know everything. As if behind the bulge of membrane, a quantity of the most precious and clear liquid in the world is held in suspense. In the suggestion of pressure behind the tranquil lid, and in the tilt of the protruding upper lip, he reads a delightful hint of disdain. She knows she's good. What he never expected, he can feel she's feminine, feels something both delicate and enduring in the arc of the long pink cranium, furred in bands with black-licked swatches. Nelson's head had been full of lumps and frightening blue veins, and bald except at the base of the neck. Rabbit looks down through the glass with a timidity in the very act of seeing, as if rough-looking will smash the fine machinery of this beautiful life. The smile of the nurse, foreshortened and flickering cutely between his eyes and the baby's nose, reassures him that he is the father. Her painted lips wrinkle a question through the glass, and he calls, okay, yeah, and gestures, throwing his hands, fingers splayed, to the height of his ears. She's great, he adds, in a forced voice meant to carry through glass, but the nurse is already returning his daughter to her supermarket basket. Rabbit turns the wrong way into the pink-lidded face of the father next in line and laughs outright. He goes back to Janice with the wind swirling through him and fire the red of the baby's skin blazing. In the soap-scented hall, he gets the idea. They should call the girl June. This is June. She was born in June. He's never known a June. It will please Janice because of the J. But Janice has been thinking about names, too, and wants to call her after her mother. Harry never thinks of Mrs. Springer as having a first name. It is Rebecca. His warm gust of pride in his child turns Janice soft in the bed, and he, in turn, is sweetened by her daughterly wish. It worries him at times that she does not seem to love her mother. They compromise. Rebecca June Angstrom. The straight path is made smooth. Mr. Springer had been paying rent on the apartment all along, it turns out. He is a personal friend of the landlord and had arranged it without troubling his daughter. He always had a hunch Harry would come back, but didn't want to advertise it in case he was wrong. Harry and Nelson move in and start housekeeping. Rabbit has a gift for housekeeping. The sensation of dust sucking into the vacuum cleaner, down the cloth hose, into a paper bag that when it is full of compact gray fluff will pop the cover of the Electrolux like a gentleman tipping his hat, pleases him. He was not entirely miscast as a barker for the Magipeel peeler. He has an instinctive taste for the small appliances of civilization, the little grinders and slicers and holders. Perhaps the oldest child should always be a girl. Mim, coming after him to the Angstrom household, was never exposed direct to the bright heart of the kitchen, but was always in his shadow with the housework, and sullen about assuming her share, which eventually became the greater share because he was, after all, a boy. He supposes it will be the same with Nelson and Rebecca. Nelson is a help. Closer to three now than two, the child can carry out orders that do not take him out of the room, understands that his toys belong in the bushel basket, and feels the happiness in cleanness, order, and light. The June breeze sighs at the screens of the long-closed windows. The sun dots the mesh with hundreds of sparkling T's and L's. Beyond the windows, Wilbur Street falls away. The flat tin and tar roofs of their neighbors, weathered into gentle corrugations, glitter with mysterious twists of rubble, candy bar wrappers, and a pool of glass flakes, litter that must have fallen from the clouds or been brought by birds to this street in the sky, planted with television aerials and hooded chimneys the size of fire hydrants. There are three of these roofs on the downside, tipped like terraces for drainage, three broad, dirty steps leading to a brink below which the better homes begin, the stucco and brick forts, rugged with porches and dormer windows and lightning rods, guarded by conifers, protected by treaties with banks and firms of lawyers. It was strange that a row of tenements had been set above them. They had been tricked by growth. But in a town built against a mountain, height was too common to be precious. Above them all, there was the primitive ridge, the dark slum of forest, separated from the decent part of town by a band of unpaved lanes, derelict farmhouses, a cemetery, and a few raw young developments. Wilbur Street was paved for a block past Rabbit's door, and then became a street of mud and gravel between two short rows of ranch houses of alternating color erected in 1953 on scraped red earth that even now gives scant support to the blades of grass that speckle it. The land grows steeper still, and the woods begin. Straight out from the windows, Rabbit can look in the opposite direction across the town into the wide farm valley with its golf course. He thinks, my valley, my home. The blemished green-papered walls, the scatter rugs whose corners keep turning under, the closet whose door bumps the television set, absent from his senses for months, have returned with unexpected force. Every corner locks against a remembered corner in his mind. Every crevice, every irregularity in the paint, clicks against a nick already in his brain. This adds another dimension of neatness to his house cleaning. Under the sofa and chairs and behind doors and in the footspace under the kitchen cabinets, he finds old fragments of toys that delight Nelson. The child has a perfect memory for his own possessions. Mom gave me this, holding up a plastic duck that had lost its wheels. She did? Yep, Mom did. Wasn't that nice of Mom? Yep. You know what? What? Mom is Mommy's mommy. Yep. Where's Mommy? At the hospital. At hospital? Come back Friday? That's right, she'll come back Friday. Won't she be happy to see how clean we make everything? Yep. Daddy at hospital? No, Daddy wasn't at the hospital. Daddy was away. Daddy away. The boy's eyes widen and his mouth drops open as he stares into the familiar concept of away. His voice deepens with the seriousness of it. Very, very long. His arms go out to measure the length. So far, his fingers bend backward. It is as long as he can measure. But Daddy's not away now, is he? Nope. He takes Nelson with him in the car the day he goes to tell Mrs. Smith he has to quit working in her garden. Old man Springer has offered him a job in one of his lots. The rhododendron trees by the crunching driveway look dusty and barren, with a few brown corsages still pinned to their branches by fronds of light green new growth. Mrs. Smith herself comes to the door. Yes, yes, she croons, her brown face beaming. Mrs. Smith, this is my son Nelson. Yes, yes, how do you do, Nelson? You have your father's head. She pats the small head with a hand withered like a tobacco leaf. Now let me think, where did I put that jar of old candy? He can eat candy, can't he? I guess a little, but don't go looking for it. I will, too, if I want to. The trouble with you, young man, you never gave me credit for any competence whatsoever. She totters off, plucking with one hand at the front of her dress and poking the other into the air before her as if she's brushing away cobwebs. While she's out of the room, he and Nelson stand looking at the high ceiling of this parlor, at the tall windows with mullions as thin as chalk lines, through whose panes, some of which are tinted lavender, they can see the pines and cypresses that guard the far rim of the estate. Paintings hang on the shining walls. One shows, in dark colors, a woman wrapped in a whipping strip of silk, apparently having an argument, from the way her arms are flailing, with a big swan that just stands there pushing. On another wall, there is a portrait of a young woman in a black gown, sitting in a padded chair impatiently. Her face, though squarish, is fine-looking, with a triangular forehead caused by her hairdo. Round white arms curve into her lap. Rabbit moves a few steps closer to get a less oblique view. She has that short, puffy little upper lip that is so good in a girl, the way it lifts to let a dab of dark come between her lips, lifted like the top petal of a blossom. There is this readiness about her all over. He feels that she's about to get out of the chair and step forward toward them with a frown on her triangular forehead. Mrs. Smith, returning with a crimson glass ball on a stem like a wine glass, sees where he's looking and says, "What I always minded was, why did he have to make me look so irritable? I didn't like him a whit, and he knew it. A slick little Italian. Thought he knew about women. Here." She has crossed to Nelson with the candy glass. "You try one of these. They're old, but good, like a lot of old things in this world." She takes off the lid, a knobbed hemisphere of turquoise glass, and holds it waggling in her hand. Nelson looks over, and Rabbit nods at him to go ahead, and he chooses a piece wrapped in colored tinfoil. "You won't like it," Rabbit tells him. "That's going to have a cherry inside." "Shush," Mrs. Smith says. "Let the boy have the one he wants." So the poor kid goes ahead and takes it, bewitched by the tinfoil. "Mrs. Smith," Rabbit begins, "I don't know if Reverend Eccles has told you, but my situation has kind of changed, and I have to take another job. I won't be able to help around here anymore. I'm sorry." "Yes, yes," she says, alertly watching Nelson fumble at the tinfoil. "I've really enjoyed it," he goes on. "It was sort of like heaven, like that woman said." "Oh, that foolish woman, Alma Foster," Mrs. Smith says, with her lipstick halfway up to her nose. "I'll never forget her, the dear soul. Not a brain in her body. Here, child, give it to Mrs. Smith." She sets the dish down on a round marble table, holding only an oriental vase full of peonies, and takes the piece of candy from Nelson, and with a frantic needling motion of her fingers, works the paper off. The kid stands there, staring up with an open mouth. She thrusts her hand down jerkily and pops the ball of chocolate between his lips. With a crease of satisfaction in one cheek, she turns, drops the tinfoil on the table, and says to Rabbit, "Well, Harry, at least we brought the roadies in." "That's right, we did. It pleased my Harry, I know, wherever he is." Nelson bites through to the startling syrup of the cherry, and his mouth curls open in dismay. A dribble of brown creeps out one corner, and his eyes dart around the immaculate palace room. Rabbit cups a hand at his side, and the kid comes over and silently spits the mess into it, bits of chocolate shell and stringy warm syrup and the broken cherry. Mrs. Smith sees none of this. Her eyes, with their transparent irises of crazed crystal, burn into Harry's as she says, "It's been a religious duty to me to keep Horace's garden up. I'm sure you can find somebody else. Vacation's started. It'd be a perfect job for some high school kid." "No," she says, "no, I won't think about it. I won't be here next year to see Harry's roadies come in again. You kept me alive, Harry. It's the truth, you did. All winter I was fighting the grave, and then in April I looked out the window, and here was this tall young man burning my old stalks, and I knew life hadn't left me. That's what you have, Harry, life. It's a strange gift, and I don't know how we're supposed to use it, but I know it's the only gift we get, and it's a good one." Her crystal eyes have filmed with a liquid thicker than tears, and she grabs his arms above his elbows with hard brown claws. "Fine, strong young man," she murmurs, and her eyes come back into focus as she adds, "You have a proud son. Take care." She must mean he should be proud of his son and take care of him. He is moved by her embrace. He wants to respond, and did moan no at her prediction of death, but his right hand is full of melting mashed candy, and he stands helpless and rigid, hearing her quaver, "Goodbye. I wish you well. I wish you well." In the week that follows this blessing, he and Nelson are often happy. They go for walks around the town. One day they watch a softball game played on the high school lot by men with dark, creased faces like mill workers, dressed in gaudy felt and flannel uniforms, one team bearing the name of a fire hall and brewer, and the other the name of the Sunshine Athletic Association, the same uniforms, he guesses, that he saw hanging in the attic the time he slept in Totheroe's bedroom. The number of spectators sitting on the dismantleable bleachers is no greater than the number of players. All around, behind the bleachers and the chicken wire and pipe backstop, kids in sneakers scuffle and run and argue. He and Nelson watch a few innings while the sun lowers into the trees. It floods Rabbit with an ancient papery warmth, the oblique sun on his cheeks, the sparse inattentive crowd, the snarled pepper chatter, the spurts of dust on the yellow infield, the girls in shorts strolling past with chocolate popsicles. Brown adolescent legs, thick at the ankle and smooth at the thigh. They know so much, at least their skins do. Boys their age, scrawny sticks in dungarees and keds, arguing frantically if Williams was washed up or not. Mantle 10,000 times better. Williams 10 million times better. He and Nelson share an orange soda bought from a man in a Boosters Club apron who has established a bin in the shade. The smoke of dry ice leaking from the ice cream section, the fp of the cap being pulled from the orange, the artificial sweetness fills his heart. Nelson spills on his chest, trying to get it to his lips. Another day they go to the playground. Nelson acts frightened of the swings. Rabbit tells him to hold on and pushes very gently from the front so the kid can see. Laughs, pleads, "Me out," begins to cry. Me out, Daddy." Dabbling in the sandbox gives Rabbit a small headache. Over at the pavilion, the rubber thump of roof ball and the click of checkers call to his memory, and the forgotten smell of that narrow plastic ribbon you braid bracelets and whistle chains out of, and of glue and of the sweat on the handles on athletic equipment is blown down by a breeze laced with children's murmuring. He feels the truth. The thing that had left his life had left irrevocably. No search would recover it. No flight would reach it. It was here, beneath the town, in these smells, in these voices, forever behind him. The best he can do is submit to the system and give Nelson the chance to pass as he did, unthinkingly, through it. The fullness ends when we give nature her ransom, when we make children for her. Then she is through with us, and we become, first inside and then outside, junk, flower stalks. They visit Mom Springer. The child is delighted. Nelson loves her, and this makes Rabbit like her. Though she tries to pick a fight with him, he refuses to fight back, just admits everything. He was a crumb, a dope. He behaved terribly. He's lucky not to be in jail. Actually, there's no real bite in her attack. Nelson is there, for one thing, and for another, she is relieved he has come back and is afraid of scaring him off. For a third, your wife's parents can't get at you the way your own can. They remain on the outside, no matter how hard they knock, and there's something relaxing and even comic about them. He and the old lady sit on the screened sun porch with iced tea. Her bandaged legs are up on a stool, and her little groans as she shifts her weight make him smile. It feels like he's visiting a silly girlfriend. Nelson and Billy Fasnacht are inside the house playing quietly. They're too quiet. Mrs. Springer wants to see what's happening, but doesn't want to move her legs. In her torment, she starts to complain about what a crude child little Billy Fasnacht is, and from this shifts over to the kid's mother. Mrs. Springer doesn't like her, doesn't trust her around the corner. It isn't just the sunglasses, though she thinks that's a ridiculous affectation. It's the girl's whole creepy manner, the way she came cozying around to Janice just because it looked like juicy gossip. Why, she came around here so much that I had more charge of Nelson than Janice did, with those two off to the movies every day like high school girls that don't have the responsibility of being mothers. Now Rabbit knows from school that Peggy Fasnacht, then Peggy Gring, wears sunglasses because she is freakishly, humiliatingly wall-eyed. And Eccles has told him that her company was a great comfort to Janice during the trying period now past. But he does not make either of these objections. He listens contentedly, pleased to be united with Mrs. Springer, the two of them against the world. The cubes in the iced tea melt, making the beverage doubly bland. His mother-in-law's talk laves his ears like the swirling mutter of a brook. Lulled, he lets his lids lower, and a smile creeps into his face. He sleeps badly at nights, alone, and drowses now on the grassy breadth of day, idly blissful, snug on the right side at last. It is quite different at his own parents' home. He and Nelson go there once. His mother is angry about something. Her anger hits his nostrils as soon as he's in the door, like a lining of dust on everything. This house looks shabby and small after the Springers. What ails her? He assumes she's always been on his side and tells her in a quick gust of confiding how terrific the Springers have been, how Mrs. Springer is really quite warm-hearted and seems to have forgiven him everything. How Mr. Springer kept up the rent on their apartment, and now has promised him a job selling cars in one of his lots. He owns four lots in Brewer and vicinity. Rabbit had no idea he was that much of an operator. He's really kind of a jerk, but a successful jerk at least. At any rate, he thinks he, Harry Angstrom, has gotten off pretty easily. His mother's hard, arched nose and steamed spectacles glitter bitterly. Her disapproval nicks him whenever she turns from the sink. At first he thinks it's that he never got in touch with her. But if that's so, she should be getting less sore instead of more, because he's in touch with her now. Then he thinks it's that she's disgusted he slept with Ruth and committed adultery. She's getting religious as she gets older, and probably thinks of him as around 12 years old anyway. But out of a clear sky, she explodes that by asking abruptly, "And what's going to happen to this poor girl you lived with in Brewer?" "Her? Oh, she can take care of herself. She didn't expect nothing." But he tastes his own saliva saying it. It makes his life seem cramped that Ruth can be mentioned out of his mother's mouth. Her mouth goes thin, and she answers with a smug flirt of her head, "I'm not saying anything, Harry. I'm not saying one word." But of course, she is saying a great deal, only he doesn't know what it is. There's some kind of clue in the way she treats Nelson. She as good as ignores him, doesn't offer him toys or hug him, just says, "Hello, Nelson," with a little nod, her glasses snapping into white circles. After Mrs. Springer's warmth, this coolness seems brutal. Nelson feels it and acts hushed and frightened and leans against his father's legs. Now, Rabbit doesn't know what's eating his mother, but she certainly shouldn't take it out on a 2-year-old kid. He never heard of a grandmother acting this way. It's true, just the poor kid's being there keeps them from having the kind of conversation they used to have, where his mother tells him something pretty funny that happened in the neighborhood, and they go on to talk about him, the way he used to be as a kid, how he dribbled the basketball all afternoon until after dark, and was always looking after Mim. Nelson's being half Springer seems to kill all that. For the moment, he stops liking his mother. It takes insanity to snub a tiny kid that just learned to talk. He wants to say to her, "What is this anyway? You act like I've gone over to the other side. You're acting insane. Don't you know it's the right side, and why don't you praise me?" But he doesn't say this. He has a stubbornness to match hers. He doesn't say much at all to her. After telling her what good sports the Springers are doesn't go over. He just hangs around, him and Nelson rolling a lemon back and forth in the kitchen. Whenever the lemon wobbles over toward his mother's feet, he has to get it. Nelson won't. The silence makes Rabbit blush. For himself or for her, he doesn't know. When his father comes home, it isn't much better. The old man isn't angry, but he looks at Harry like there isn't anything there. His weary hunch and filthy fingernails annoy his son. It's as if he's willfully aging them all. Why doesn't he get false teeth that fit? His mouth works like an old woman's. But one thing at least, his father pays some attention to Nelson, who hopefully rolls the lemon toward him. He rolls it back. "You going to be a ball player like your dad?" "He can't, Earl," Mom interrupts, and Rabbit is happy to hear her voice, thinks the ice has broken, until he hears what she says. "Those little Springer hands." These words, spoken hard as steel, strike a flurry of sparks off Rabbit's heart. "The hell he does," he says, and regrets it, being trapped. It shouldn't matter what size hands Nelson has. Now he discovers it does matter. He doesn't want the boy to have his mother's hands, and if he does, and if Mom noticed it, he probably does, he likes the kid a little less. He likes the kid a little less, but he hates his mother for making him do it. It's as if she wants to pull down everything, even if it falls on her. And he admires this, her willingness to have him hate her, so long as he gets her message. But he rejects her message. He feels it probing at his heart and rejects it. He doesn't want to hear it. He doesn't want to hear her say another word. He just wants to get out with a little piece of his love of her left. At the door, he asks his father, "Where's Mim?" "We don't see much of Mim anymore," the old man says. His blurred eyes sink and he touches the pocket of his shirt, which holds 2 ballpoint pens and a little soiled packet of cards and papers. Just in these last few years, his father has been making little bundles of things. Cards and lists and receipts and tiny calendars that he wraps rubber bands around and tucks into different pockets with an elderly fussiness. Rabbit leaves his old home depressed, with a feeling of his heart having slumped off center. The days go all right as long as Nelson is awake, but when the boy falls asleep, when his face sags asleep and his breath drags in and out of helpless lips that deposit spots of spit on the crib sheet, and his hair fans in fine tufts, and the perfect skin of his fat, slack cheeks, drained of animation, lies sealed under a heavy flush, then a dead place opens in Harry, and he feels fear. The child's sleep is so heavy, he fears it might break the membrane of life and fall through to oblivion. Sometimes he reaches into the crib and lifts the boy's body out, just to reassure himself with its warmth and the responsive fumbling protest of the tumbled, limp limbs. He rattles around in the apartment, turning on all the lights and television, drinking ginger ale and leafing through old lifes, grabbing anything to stuff into the emptiness. Before going to bed himself, he stands Nelson in front of the toilet, running the faucet and stroking the taut, bare bottom until wee-wee springs from the child's irritated sleep and jerkily prinkles into the bowl. Then he wraps a diaper around Nelson's middle and returns him to the crib and braces himself to leap the deep gulf between here and the moment when in the furry slant of morning sun the boy will appear resurrected in sopping diapers beside the big bed, patting his father's face experimentally. Sometimes he gets into the bed, and then the clammy, cold cloth, shocking rabbit skin, is like retouching a wet, solid shore. The time in between is of no use to Rabbit, but the urgency of his wish to glide over it balks him. He lies in bed, diagonally, so his feet do not hang over, and fights the tipping sensation inside him. Like an unsteered boat, he keeps scraping against the same rocks, his mother's ugly behavior, his father's gaze of desertion, Ruth's silence the last time he saw her, his mother's oppressive not saying a word. What ails her? He rolls over on his stomach and seems to look down into a bottomless sea, down and down to where crusty crags gesture amid blind lead. Good old Ruth in the swimming pool. That poor jerk Harrison sweating it out Ivy League style, the son of a bitch. Margaret's weak little dirty hand flipping over into Totharo's mouth, and Totharo lying there with his tongue floating around under twittering jellied eyes. No, he doesn't want to think about that. He rolls over on his back in the hot, dry bed, and the tipping sensation returns severely. Think of something pleasant. Basketball and cider at that little school down at the end of the county, Oriole High. But it's too far back. He can't remember more than the cider and the way the crowd sat up on the stage. Ruth at the swimming pool. The way she lay in the water without weight, rounded by the water, slipping backwards through it, eyes shut and then out of the water with the towel, him looking up her legs at the secret hair, and then her face lying beside him, huge and yellow and still, dead. No, he must blot Totharo and Ruth out of his mind. Both remind him of death. They make on one side this vacuum of death, and on the other side the threat of Janice coming home grows. That's what makes him feel tipped, lopsided. Though he's lying there alone, he feels crowded. All these people troubling about him, not so much their faces or words as their mute, dense presences, pushing in the dark like crags underwater, and under everything, like a faint high hum, Eccles' wife's wink. That wink, what was it? Just a little joke in the tangle at the door? The kid coming down in her underpants, and maybe she conscious of him looking at her toenails. A little click of the eye saying, on your way, good luck. Or was it a chink of light in a dark hall saying, come in? Funny, wise, freckled piece. He ought to have nailed her. That steady, high hum bothering him ever since she wanted him to really nail her, the shadow of her bra, tipped bumps. In a room full of light, slips down the shorts over the child's skin thighs, fat butt, two globes hanging of white in the light, Freud in the white-painted parlor, hung with watercolors of canals. Come here, you primitive father, canals on the sofa, she sits, spreads like two white gates parted. What a nice chest you have, and here, and here, and here. He rolls over, and the dry sheet is the touch of her anxious hands, himself tapering tall up from furred velvet, ridges through which the thick vein strains, and he does what he must, with a tight, knowing hand, to stop the high hum and make himself slack for sleep. A woman's sweet froth nails her, passes through the diamond standing on his head, and comes out on the other side wet. How silly. He feels sorry. Queer where the wet is, nowhere near where you'd think, on the top sheet instead of the bottom. He puts his cheek on a fresh patch of pillow. He tips less, Lucy undone. Her white lines drift off like unraveled string. He must sleep. The thought of the far shore approaching makes a stubborn lump in his glide. Think of things pleasant. Out of all his remembered life, the one place that comes forward where he can stand without the ground turning into faces he is treading on is that lot outside the diner in West Virginia after he went in and had a cup of coffee the night he drove down there. He remembers the mountains around him like a ring of cutouts against the moon-bleached blue of the night sky. He remembers the diner with its golden windows like the windows of the trolley cars that used to run from Mount Judge into Brewer when he was a kid. and the air, cold but soft with the beginnings of spring. He hears the footsteps tapping behind him on the asphalt and sees the couple running toward their car, hands linked. One of the red-haired girls that sat inside with her hair hanging down like seaweed. And it seems right here that he made the mistaken turning, that he should have followed, that they meant to lead him, and he should have followed. And it seems to him in his disintegrating state that he did follow, that he is following, like a musical note that all the while it is being held seems to travel, though it stays in the same place. On this note he carries into sleep. But awakes before dawn, being tipped again, frightened on the empty bed, with the fear that Nelson has died. He tries to sneak back into the dream he was having, but his nightmare fear dilates, and he at last gets up and goes to hear the boy breathe, and then urinates with slight pain, and returns to a bed whose wrinkles, the first stirrings of light, are etching into black lines. On this net he lies down, and steals the hour left before the boy comes to him hungry and cold. On Friday, Janice comes home. For the first days, the presence of the baby fills the apartment as a little casket of incense fills a chapel. Rebecca June lies in a bassinet of plaited rushes, painted white, and mounted on a trundle. When Rabbit goes over to look at her, to reassure himself that she is there, he sees her somehow dimly, as if the baby has not gathered to herself the force that makes a silhouette. Her averted cheek, drained of the bright red he glimpsed at the hospital, is mottled gray, yellow, and blue, marbled like the palms of his hands when he is queasy. When Janice suckles Rebecca, yellow spots well up on her breast as if in answer to the fainter shadows of this color in the baby's skin. The union of breast and baby's face makes a globular symmetry to which both he and Nelson want to attach themselves. When Rebecca nurses, Nelson becomes agitated, climbs against them, pokes his fingers into the seam between the baby's lips and his mother's udder, and, scolded and pushed away, wanders around the bed intoning a promise he has heard on television, "Mighty Mouse is on the way." Rabbit himself loves to lie beside them, watching Janice manipulate her swollen breasts, the white skin shiny from fullness. She thrusts the thick nipples like a weapon into the blind, blistered mouth that opens and grips with birdie quickness. "Ow!" Janice winces, and then the glands within the baby's lips begin to bubble in tune with her milk-making glands. The symmetry is established. Her face relaxes into a downward smile. She holds a diaper against the other breast, mopping the waste milk it exudes in sympathy. Those first days, full of rest and hospital health, she has more milk than the baby takes. Between feedings, she leaks. The bodices of all her nighties bear two stiff stains. When he sees her naked, naked all but for the elastic belt that holds her modest pad in place, her belly shaved and puffed and soft, his whole stomach stirs at the fierce sight of her breasts, braced high by the tension of their milk, jutting from her slim body like glossy green-veined fruit with coarse purple tips. Top-heavy, bandaged, Janice moves gingerly as if she might spill, jarred. Though with the baby her breasts are used without shame, tools like her hands before his eyes, she is still shy and quick to cover herself if he watches too openly. But he feels a difference between now and when they first loved, lying side by side on the borrowed bed, his eyes closed, together making the filmy sideways descent into one another. Now she is intermittently careless, walks out of the bathroom naked, lets her straps hang down while she burps the baby, seems to accept herself with casual gratitude as a machine, a white, pliant machine for loving, hatching, feeding. He, too, leaks. Thick, sweet love burdens his chest, and he wants her. Just a touch. He knows she's a bleeding wound, but just a touch, just enough to get rid of his milk, give it to her. Though in her ether trance she spoke of making love, she turns away from him in bed and sleeps with a heaviness that feels sullen. He is too grateful, too proud of her to disobey. He, in a way this week, worships her. Eccles comes calling and says he hopes to see them in church. Their debt to him is such that they agree it would be nice of them, at least one of them, to go. The one must be Harry. Janice can't. She has been by this Sunday out of the hospital 9 days, and with Harry off at his new job since Monday, is beginning to feel worn out, weak, and abused. Harry is happy to go to Eccles Church, not merely out of affection for Eccles, though there's that, but because he considers himself happy, lucky, blessed, forgiven, and wants to give thanks. His feeling that there is an unseen world is instinctive, and more of his actions than anyone suspects constitute transactions with it. He dresses in his new gray suit and steps out at 11:15 into a broad blue Sunday morning, a day before the summer solstice. He always envied those people parading into church across from Ruth's place, and now he is one of them. Ahead of him is the first hour in over a week when he won't be with a Springer, either Janice at home or her father at work. The job at the lot is easy enough, if it isn't any work for you to lie. He feels exhausted by mid-afternoon. You see these clunkers come in with 80,000 miles on them, and the pistons so loose the oil just pours through, and they get a washing and the speedometer turned back, and you hear yourself saying this represents a real bargain, owned by a man with two cars and not 30,000 miles of wear in it. He'll ask forgiveness. He hates all the people on the street in dirty everyday clothes, advertising their belief that the world arches over a pit, that death is final, that the wandering thread of his feelings leads nowhere. Correspondingly, he loves the ones dressed for church. The pressed business suits of portly men give substance and respectability to his furtive sensations of the invisible. The flowers in the hats of their wives seem to begin to make it visible, and their daughters are themselves whole flowers, their bodies each a single flower, petaled in gauze and frills, a bloom of faith, so that even the plainest, sandwiched between their parents with olive complexions and bony arms, walk in rabbit's eyes glowing with beauty, the beauty of belief. He could kiss their feet in gratitude. They release him from fear. By the time he enters the church, he is too elevated with happiness to ask forgiveness. As he kneels in the pew on a red stool that is padded, but not enough to keep his weight from pinching his knees painfully, his head buzzes with joy. His blood leaps in his skull, and the few words he frames, God, Rebecca, thank you, bob inconsecutively among senseless eddies of gladness. He is surrounded by people who know God. He has come into a field of flowers. When he sinks back into sitting position, the head in front of him takes his eye, a woman in a wide straw hat. Smaller than average, with narrow, freckled shoulders, probably young, though women tend to look young from the back. The straw hat is so fresh, so pleasing. The way it broadcasts the gentlest tilt of her head. The way it turns the twist of blonde hair at the nape of her neck into a kind of peeping secret he alone knows. She is young. Her neck and shoulders are given a faint, shifting lambency by their coat of fine white hairs, invisible except where the grain lies with the light. He smiles, remembering Totheroe talking about women being covered all over with hair. He wonders if Totheroe is dead now, and quickly prays not. He becomes impatient for the woman to turn, so he can see her profile under the rim of the hat, a great woven sun wheel garnished with an arc of paper violets. She turns to look down at something beside her. His breath catches. The thinnest crescent of cheek gleams and is eclipsed again. Something in a pink ribbon pops up beside her shoulder. He stares into the inquisitive, delighted face of little Joyce Eccles. His fingers fumble for the hymnal as the organ heaves into the service. It is Eccles' wife rising within reach of his arm. Eccles comes down the aisle, shuffling behind a flood of acolytes and choristers. Up behind the altar rail, he looks absent-minded and grouchy, remote and insubstantial and stiff, like a Japanese doll in his vestments. The affected voice, nasal pious, in which he intones prayers, affects Rabbit disagreeably. There is something disagreeable about the whole Episcopal service, with its strenuous ups and downs, its canned petitions, its cursory little chants. He has trouble with the kneeling pad. The small of his back aches. He hooks his elbows over the back of the pew in front of him to keep from falling backward. He misses the familiar Lutheran liturgy, scratched into his heart like a weathered inscription. In this service, he blunders absurdly, balked by what seem willful dislocations of worship. He feels too much is made of collecting the money. He scarcely listens to the sermon at all. It concerns the 40 days in the wilderness and Christ's conversation with the devil. Does this story have any relevance to us, here, now, in the 20th century in the United States of America? Yes. There exists a sense in which all Christians must have conversations with the devil, must learn his ways, must hear his voice. The tradition behind this legend is very ancient, was passed from mouth to mouth among the early Christians. Its larger significance, its greater meaning, Eccles takes to be this: suffering, deprivation, barrenness, hardship, lack are all an indispensable part of the education, the initiation, as it were, of any of those who would follow Jesus Christ. Eccles wrestles in the pulpit with the squeak in his voice. His eyebrows jiggle as if on fish hooks. It is an unpleasant and strained performance, contorted somehow. He drives his car with an easier piety. In his robes, he seems the sinister priest of a drab mystery. Harry has no taste for the dark, tangled, visceral aspect of Christianity, the going-through quality of it, the passage into death and suffering that redeems and inverts these things, like an umbrella blowing inside out. He lacks the mindful will to walk the straight line of a paradox. His eyes turn toward the light, however, it glances into his retina. Lucy Eccles' bright cheek ducks in and out of view under its shield of straw. The child, hidden, all but her ribbon, behind the back of the pew, whispers to her, presumably that he is behind them. Yet the woman never turns her head directly to see. This needless snub excites him. The most he gets is her profile. The soft tuck of doubleness in her chin deepens as she frowns down at the child beside her. She wears a dress whose narrow blue stripes meet at the seams in numerous sharp V's. The smart fabric and cut of the cloth on her shoulders clash with the church, yet submit to it. There is something sexed in her stillness in the church, in her obedience to its manly, crusted, rigid procedure. He flatters himself that her true attention radiates backwards at him. Against the dour patchwork of subdued heads, stained glass, yellowing memorial plaques on the wall, and laboriously knobbed and beaded woodwork, her hair and skin and hat glow singly, their differences in tint like the shades of brilliance within one flame. So that when the sermon yields to a hymn, and her bright nape bows to receive the benediction, and the nervous moment of silence passes, and she stands and faces him, it is anticlimactic to see her face, with its pointed collection of dots, eyes and nostrils and freckles and the tight, faint dimples that bring a sarcastic tension to the corners of her mouth. That she wears a facial expression at all shocks him slightly. The luminous view he had enjoyed for an hour did not seem capable of being so swiftly narrowed into one small person. "Hey, hi," he says. "Hello," she says. "You're the last person I ever expected to see here." Why? He is pleased that she thinks of him as an ultimate. "I don't know. You just don't seem the institutional type." He watches her eyes for another wink. He has lost belief in that first one weeks ago. She returns his gaze until his eyes drop. "Hello, Joyce," he says. "How are you?" The little girl halts and hides behind her mother, who continues to maneuver down the aisle, walking with small, smooth steps, brightly distributing smiles to the faces of the sheep. He has to admire her social coordination. At the door, Eccles clasps Harry's hand with his broad grip, a warm grip that tightens at the moment it should loosen. "It's exhilarating to see you here," he says, hanging on. Rabbit feels the whole line behind him bunch and push. "Nice to be here," he says. "Very nice sermon." Eccles, who has been peering at him with a feverish smile and a blush that seems apologetic, laughs. The roof of his mouth glimmers a second, and he lets go. Harry hears him tell Lucy in about an hour, "The roast's in now. Do you want it cold or overdone?" "Overdone," he says. He solemnly takes Joyce's tiny hand and says, "How do you do, Mrs. Pettigrew? How splendid you look this morning." Startled, Rabbit turns and sees that the fat lady next in line is startled also. His wife is right. Eccles is indiscreet. Lucy, Joyce behind her, walks up beside him. Her straw hat comes up to his shoulder. Do you have a car? No, do you? No. Walk along with us. Okay. Her proposition is so bold, there must be nothing in it. Nevertheless, the harp string in his chest, tuned to her, starts trembling. Sunshine quivers through the trees. In the streets and along unshaded sections of the pavement, it leans down with a broad, dry weight. It has lost the grainy milkiness of morning sun. Mica fragments in the pavement glitter. The hoods and windows of hurrying cars smear the air with white reflections. She pulls off her hat and shakes her hair. The church crowd thins behind them. The waxy leaves, freshly thick of the maples planted between the pavement and curb, embower them rhythmically. In the broad gaps of sun, her face, his shirt, feel white. White. The rush of motors, the squeak of a tricycle, the touch of a cup and saucer inside a house are sounds conveyed to him as if along a bright steel bar. As they walk along, he trembles in light that seems her light. How are your wife and baby? She asks. Fine. They're just fine. Good. Do you like your new job? Not much. Oh, that's a bad sign, isn't it? I don't know. I don't suppose you're supposed to like your job. If you did, then it wouldn't be a job. Jack likes his job. Then it's not a job. That's what he says. He says it's not a job, as I would treat it. But I'm sure you know his line as well as I do. He knows she's needling him, but he doesn't feel it, tingling all over anyway. He and I, in some ways, I guess, are alike, he says. I know, I know. Her odd quickness in saying this sets his heart ticking quicker. She adds, but naturally it's the differences that I notice. Her voice curls dryly into the end of this sentence. Her lower lip goes sideways. What is this? He has a sensation of touching glass. He doesn't know if they are talking about nothing or making code for the deepest meanings. He doesn't know if she's a conscious or unconscious flirt. He always thinks when they meet again, he will speak firmly and tell her he loves her or something is blunt and lay the truth bare. But in her presence, he is numb. His breath fogs the glass and he has trouble thinking of anything to say, and what he does say is stupid. He knows only this. Underneath everything, under their minds and their situations, he possesses, like an inherited lien on a distant piece of land, a dominance over her. And that in her grain, in the lie of her hair and nerves and fine veins, she is prepared for this dominance. But between that preparedness and him, everything reasonable intervenes. He asks, like what? Oh, like the fact that you're not afraid of women? Who is? Jack. You think? Of course. The old ones and the teenagers he's fine with, the ones who see him in his collar. But the others he's very leery of. He doesn't like them. He doesn't really think they even ought to come to church. They bring a smell of babies and bed into it. That's not just in Jack. That's in Christianity. It's really a very neurotic religion. Somehow, when she fetches out her psychology, it seems so foolish to Harry, his own feeling of foolishness leaves him. Stepping down off a high curb, he takes her arm. Mount Judge, built on its hillsides, is full of high curbs, difficult for little women to negotiate gracefully. Her bare arm remains cool in his fingers. Don't tell that to the parishioners, he says. See, you sound just like Jack. Is that good or bad? There. This seems to him to test her bluff. She may say either good or bad, and that will be the fork in the road. But she says nothing. He feels the effort of self-control this takes. She is accustomed to making replies. They mount the opposite curb, and he lets go of her arm awkwardly. Though he is awkward, there is still this sense of being nestled against a receptive grain, of fitting. Mommy? Joyce asks. What? What's rotic? Rotic? Oh, neurotic. It's when you're a little bit sick in the head. Like a cold in the head? Well, yes, in a way. It's about that serious. Don't worry about it, sweetie. It's something most everybody is, except our friend Mr. Angstrom. The little girl looks up at him across her mother's thighs with a spreading smile of self-conscious impudence. He's naughty, she says. Not very, her mother says. At the end of the rectory's brick walk, A blue tricycle has been abandoned, and Joyce runs ahead and mounts it and rides away in her aqua Sunday coat and pink hair ribbon, metal squeaking, spinning ventriloquistic threads of noise into the air. Together they watch the child a moment, then Lucy asks, "Do you want to come in?" In waiting for his reply, she contemplates his shoulder. Her white lids, from his angle, hide her eyes. Her lips are parted, and her tongue, a movement in her jaw tells him, touches the roof of her mouth. In the noon sun, her features show sharp, and her lipstick looks cracked. He can see the inner lining of her lower lip wet against her teeth. A delayed gust of the sermon, its anguished, exhortatory flavor, like a dusty breeze off the desert, sweeps through him, accompanied grotesquely by a vision of Janice's breasts, green-veined, tender. This wicked snip wants to pluck him from them. "No, thanks, really, I can't." "Oh, come on, you've been to church. Have a reward. Have some coffee." "No, look." His words come out soft, but somehow big. "You're a doll, but I got this wife now." And his hands, rising from his sides in vague explanation, cause her to take a quick step backward. "I beg your pardon." He is conscious of nothing but the little speckled section of her green irises like torn tissue paper around her black pupil dots. Then he is watching her tight round butt jounce up the walk. "But thanks anyway," he calls in a hollowed, gutless voice. He dreads being hated. She slams the door behind her so hard, the knocker clacks by itself on the empty porch. He walks home, blind to the sunlight. Was she mad because he had turned down a proposition, or because he had shown that he thought she had made one? Or was it a mixture of these opposites that had somehow exposed her to herself? His mother, suddenly caught in some confusion of her own, would turn on the heat that way. In either case, he smiles. He feels tall and elegant and potential striding along under the trees in his Sunday suit. Whether spurned or misunderstood, Eccles' wife has jazzed him, and he reaches his apartment clever and cold with lust. His wish to make love to Janice is like a small angel to which all afternoon tiny lead weights are attached. The baby squawks tirelessly. It lies in its crib all afternoon and makes an infuriating noise of strain. A persistent, feeble scratching at some interior door. What does it want? Why won't it sleep? He has come home from church carrying something precious for Janice and keeps being screened from giving it to her. The noise spreads fear through the apartment. It makes his stomach ache. When he picks up the baby to burp her, he burps himself. The pressure in his stomach keeps breaking and reforming into a stretched bubble, as the bubble in the baby doesn't break. The tiny, soft, marbled body, weightless as paper, goes stiff against his chest and then floppy, its hot head rolling as if it will unjoint from its neck. "Becky, Becky, Becky," he says, "go to sleep, 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 sleep." The noise makes Nelson fretful and whiny, as if being closest to the dark gate from which the baby has recently emerged, he is most sensitive to the threat the infant is trying to warn them of. Some shadow invisible to their better-formed senses seems to grab Rebecca as soon as she is left alone. Rabbit puts her down, tiptoes into the living room. They hold their breath. Then, with a bitter scratch, the membrane of silence breaks, and the wobbly moan begins again. "Oh, my God," Rabbit says. "Son of a bitch, son of a bitch." Around 5 in the afternoon, Janice begins to cry. Tears burble down her dark, pinched face. "I'm dry," she says. "I'm dry. I just don't have anything to feed her." The baby has been at her breasts repeatedly. "Forget it," he says. "She'll conk out. Have a drink. There's some old whiskey in the kitchen." "Say, what is this have a drink routine of yours? I've been trying not to drink. I thought you didn't like me to drink. All afternoon you've been smoking one cigarette after another and saying, have a drink, have a drink. I thought it might loosen you up. You're tense as hell." "I'm no tenser than you are. What's eating you? What's on your mind?" "What's happened to your milk? Why can't you give the kid enough milk?" "I've fed her 3 times in 4 hours. There's nothing there anymore." In a plain, impoverished gesture, she presses her breasts through her dress. "Well, have a drink of something." "Say, what did they tell you at church? Go on home and get your wife soused? You have a drink, if that's on your mind." I don't need a drink. Well, you need something. You're the ones upsetting Becky. She was fine all morning until you came home. Forget it. Just forget it. Just forget the whole stinking thing. Baby, cry. Janice puts her arm around Nelson. I know it, honey. She's hot. She'll stop in a minute. Baby, hot? They listen for a minute, and it does not stop. The wild, feeble warning, broken by tantalizing gaps of silence, goes on and on. Warned, but not knowing of what, they blunder about restlessly through the wreckage of the Sunday paper, inside the apartment, whose walls sweat like the walls of a prison. Outside, the sky holds a wide, queenly state, blue through the hours, and Rabbit is further panicked by the thought that on such a day his parents used to take them on long, pleasant walks, that they are wasting a beautiful Sunday. But they can't get organized enough to get out. He and Nelson could go, but Nelson's strange fright makes him reluctant to leave his mother, and Rabbit, hoping to possess her eventually, hovers near her like a miser near treasure. His lust glues them together. She feels this and is oppressed by it. Why don't you go out? You're making the baby nervous. You're making me nervous. Don't you want a drink? No, no. I just wish you'd sit down or stop smoking or rock the baby or something and stop touching me. It's too hot. I think I should be back at the hospital. Do you hurt? I mean down there? Well, I wouldn't if the baby would stop. I've fed her three times. Now I must feed you supper. Oh, Sundays make me sick. What did you do in church that makes you so busy? I'm not busy. I'm trying to be helpful. I know. That's what's so unnatural. Your skin smells funny. How? Oh, I don't know. Stop bothering me. I love you. Stop it. You can't. I'm not lovable right now. You just lie down on the sofa and I'll make some soup. No, no, no. You give Nelson his bath. I'll try to nurse the baby again. Poor thing, there's nothing there. They eat supper late, but in broad light. The day is one of the longest of the year. They sip soup by the flickering light of Rebecca's urgent cries. Her fragile voice is a thin filament burning with erratic injections of power. But as, amid the stacked dishes on the sink, under the worn and humid furniture, and in the coffin-like hollow of the plated crib, the shadows begin to strengthen, the grip of the one with which Becky has been struggling all afternoon relaxes, and suddenly she is quiet, leaving behind a solemn, guilty peace. They had failed her. A foreigner, speaking no English, but pregnant with a great painful worry, had been placed among them, and they had failed her. At last, night itself had swept in and washed her away like a broken piece of rubbish. It couldn't have been colic. She's too young for colic, Janice says. Maybe she was just hungry. Maybe I'm out of milk. How could that be? You've been like footballs. She looks at him, squinting, sensing what's up. Well, don't think you're going to play. But he thinks he spies a smile there. Nelson goes to bed, as he does when he's sick, willingly, whimpering. His sister was a drain on him today. Sunk in the pillow, Nelson's brown head looks demure and compact. As the child hungrily roots the bottle in his mouth, Rabbit hovers, seeking what you never find, the expression with which to communicate, to transfer those fleeting burdens, ominous and affectionate, that are placed upon us and as quickly lifted, like the touch of a brush. Obscure repentance clouds his mouth, a repentance out of time and action, a mourning simply that he exists in a world where the brown heads of little boys sink gratefully into narrow beds, sucking bottles of rubber and glass. He cups his hand over the bulge of Nelson's forehead. The boy drowsily tries to brush it off, waggles his head with irritation, and Harry takes it away and goes into the other room. He persuades Janice to have a drink. He makes it. He doesn't know much about alcoholic things, of half whiskey and half water. She says it tastes hateful, but after a while consumes it. In bed, he imagines that he can feel its difference in her flesh. There is that feeling of her body coming into his hand, a fitting his palm that makes a welcome texture. All under her nightie, up to the pit of her throat, her body is still for him. They lie sideways, facing each other. He rubs her back, first lightly, then toughly, pushing her chest against his, and gathers such a feel of strength from her pliancy that he gets up on an elbow to be above her. He kisses her dark, hard face scented with alcohol. She does not turn her head, but he reads no rejection in the small refusal of motion that lets him peck away awkwardly at a profile. He stifles his tide of resentment, reschooling himself in her slowness. Proud of his patience, he resumes rubbing her back. Her skin keeps its secret, as does her tongue. Is she feeling it? She is mysterious against him. A sullen weight whose chemistry is impervious to ideas, impregnable to their penetration. Is he kindling the spark? His wrist aches. He dares undo the two buttons of her nighty front and lifts the leaf of cloth so a long arc is exposed in the rich gloom of the bed, and her warm breast flattens against the bare skin of his chest. She submits to this maneuver, and he is filled with the joyful thought that he has brought her to this fullness. He is a good lover. He relaxes into the warmth of the bed and pulls the bow on his pajama waist. She has been shaved and scratches. He settles lower on the cotton patch. This unnaturalness, this reminder of her wound, makes his confidence delicate. So he is totally destroyed when her voice, her thin, rasping, dumb girl's voice, says by his ear, "Harry, don't you know I want to go to sleep? Well, why didn't you tell me before?" "I don't know. I didn't know." "Didn't know what?" "I didn't know what you were doing. I thought you were just being nice." "So this isn't nice?" "Well, it's not nice when I can't do anything." "You can do something." "No, I can't. Even if I wasn't all tired and confused from Rebecca's crying all day, I can't. Not for 6 weeks. You know that." "Yeah, I know, but I thought..." He's terribly embarrassed. "What did you think?" "I thought you might love me anyway." After a pause, she says, "I do love you. Just a touch, Jan. Just let me touch you. Can't you go to sleep?" "No, I can't. I can't. I love you too much. Just hold still." It would have been easy a minute ago to get it over with, but all this talk has taken the fine point off. It's a bad contact, and her stubborn limpness makes it worse. She's killing it by making him feel sorry for her and ashamed and foolish. The whole sweet thing is just sweat and work, and his ridiculous inability to finish it against the dead hot wall of her belly. She pushes him back. "You're just using me," she says. "It feels horrible. Please, baby, I'm almost there." "It feels so cheap." Her daring to say this infuriates him. He realizes she hasn't had it for 3 months, and in all that time has gotten an unreal idea of what love is. She exaggerates its importance, has imagined it into something rare and precious she's entitled to half of, when all he wants is to get rid of it so he can move on into sleep, down the straight path, for her sake. It's for her sake. "Roll over," he says. "I love you," she says with relief, misunderstanding, thinking he's dismissing her. She touches his face in farewell and turns her back. He scrunches down and fits himself between her buttocks, cool. It's beginning to work, steady, warm, when she twists her head and says over her shoulder, "Is this a trick your whore taught you?" He thumps her shoulder with his fist and gets out of bed, and his pajama bottoms fall down. The night breeze filters in through the window screen. She turns over on her back into the center of the bed and explains out of her dark face, "I'm not your whore, Harry." "Damn it," he says. "That was the first thing I've asked from you since you came home." "You've been wonderful," she says. "Thanks. Where are you going?" He is putting on his clothes. "I'm going out. I've been cooped up in this damn hole all day." "You went out this morning?" He finds his suntans and puts them on. She asks, "Why can't you imagine how I feel? I've just had a baby."